To the left, to the left. Apply lip gloss, take drink.
Would you like some lip gloss?
I would like no lip gloss, thank you very much.
Yep. What a
loser. Okay, so which part do I include in the pre-roll? The what a loser part, or do you want more lip gloss? Hey, I'm Alex Radcliffe from Board Game Co.
I'm Professor Meg.
And today we're doing the top 10 best games in Professor Meg's collection.
Yes.
This is a follow-up video to the top 10 worst games in Professor Meg's collection. I'll link to that down below, as well as to your channel, hopefully, if I remember.
Yeah, sure.
Hopefully, yeah, all those things. Yeah, it does exist. It's
follow
a channel.
Follow me on Instagram.
You can do that too. I'll link to Instagram below as well. But I did a video, I don't remember how long ago, some time ago.
A few months.
Well, the problem is I don't know when this video goes up, so it's hard to actually answer the question as to how long ago the last video was.
Well, IRL to us.
IRL, or IRL is 2 months ago.
Yeah.
2 months ago, I filmed a video, top 10 worst games in Professor Meg's collection. Somebody, go ahead.
So I've changed my hair color since then, and then back to something similar.
Similar yet different. But someone suggested, why don't we do the top 10 best games in your collection?
That was me.
That was not you.
Yes, it was.
Was it in the video?
It was in the video.
Oh, someone! I thought it was a comment in the video. Was it not a comment in the video?
Someone, I think people agreed and said that would be a good idea.
That is a good idea. Good job, Past Meg.
I believe, Alex, you've done a few different top 10 worst games in people's collections, but you've never done a top 10 of someone else's collection.
I'm going to have to visit them all again. All of them.
Sure, but I'm the first.
Chris George, I'll be coming to you.
I'm the trendsetter.
Chris George, I'll be heading your way. Board Game Coffee, I'll be heading your way. And yep. Jesse, I'll be heading your way to do the top 10 best games in each of these various collections. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. In any case.
Which I kind of like with your disclaimer for the worst games. For the best games, mine is a free-for-all.
You what do you mean?
Because when you do their collections, you won't pick any you've picked today, right?
Oh, interesting.
So I like that I get the best of the best.
Yes-ish. I don't know if I have the same rule. So for context, she's referring to the rule that I don't harp on the same games being bad again and again and again.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't know if I would have as much pedanticness about the same rule. Meaning, I would probably, here's the deal, if I walk into Jesse's collection and Jesse has, like, basically the same games and I feel inclined to pick half of them, I'm probably going to mix it up. But I don't know if I'd be as precise about not picking any. And I think part of the reason is because I always want to share good games. I always want to share good games. Yeah. I want to be like, yes, you should play this game. It is the best. I don't care how many times you hear it from me. But I'm a little mindful of how many times I want to hate on a game, especially if it's a popular game. Like, you should know my opinion is that I don't align with that popular opinion, but, like, you don't need to hear it 14 times.
That's fair.
Also, I don't need to hear how wrong I am 14 times. Maybe that's the real issue. Maybe that's the real issue. In any case, with all that preamble out aside, away, do we have anything else we need to cover? There is a disclaimer that Meg did want me to pick only games that I know she has played, or actually said I can check your collection. Happens to be the games that I think are the best in your collection.
Yes.
I think there was only one that I was even remotely hesitant as to whether you had or had not played. I'm trying to find it. You can't look behind you. I could.
I won't.
There was... Well, and by the way, eagle-eyed viewers of Professor Meg's collection can go ahead and already see potentially some of the games that have been picked if you notice what has and has not been moved. There was a one game
and
that I was
inclined... And I'm looking around. Oh, interesting.
Uh-oh, you said an interesting?
Yeah.
Oh, so the problem is you're seeing something missing from the shelf, but what if it was just used to proxy something else over there?
Yeah, I'm thinking Cascadia is still over there.
Cascadia is one of the ones that I was wondering about picking, but I didn't. It was on my...
Interesting.
Let's do that. Here's my picks 13, 12, and 11. Other way, let's get 13 picks.
Okay, yeah, sure, sure.
So pick number 13 that did not make the cut was Spirit Island. It was actually one of my first 10 originally, but then I kind of was like leaning into like, I was like, I don't really know how it's going to play out. So I've been feeling a little bit like I'm getting a little tired of Spirit Island. And I need to play the expansions.
Yeah.
But until that happens, I was like, you know what? We're going to hold off in Spirit Island. Pick number 12 is Cascadia. I love Cascadia. Mm-hmm. I adore Cascadia. I don't have the same level of highs and excitement that I have about Cascadia that I have about other games. So I chose not to pick Cascadia, but I do love it. It's a great game. And pick number 11 was The Loop from Pandasaurus Games.
Okay, yeah.
I've really been enjoying Pandasaurus. I've really been enjoying The Loop a lot as I play through it. In fact, it might...
Those are all great.
Yeah, it's a great game. It's an absolutely great game. I really like it a lot. I think I just need more time with it to be able to really solidify just how strongly I feel. Like, where I am right now, if you ask me if I prefer to play Spirit Island or The Loop right now, I would pick The Loop. I don't think that holds up long term. I think that's the fact that I've played The Loop like 4 times and I've played Spirit Island like 15 times or more than 15 times. Like, who am I?
The thing I really enjoy about The Loop is that I'm someone that likes to plan their turns ahead of time, that within like 3 turns ahead, I'm already planning what I think I want to do.
Yeah.
And with The Loop, you cannot do that at all. With the way the board changes, you really just can't plan for future turns. That I like that, but I don't think I love that.
Mm.
I enjoy that The Loop does it, but I don't know if it would be a favorite.
I'm trying to remember the game that I almost picked. There was one game that I was debating picking. Oh, there was one game that I wanted to pick that I couldn't because you hadn't played it, which is Kemet.
Yeah.
But I know you haven't played Kemet, so that one's out.
We should play that.
Yeah. Yeah, that's we should play Kemet. We should play Kemet. Yeah, we should. Maybe when Roberta comes over. That's a good game. I can do that one. I know Kemet. I can do that.
I would love that.
Anyway, so those are some of the disclaimers of the things that didn't make the cut. And again, the...
Oh, that makes me think I know. Oh my gosh, I hope everything's fine up there.
Okay, that... either way, as far as how things go. So that's the stuff. And that disclaimer may or may not be a requirement for other people's collections. I don't know. Don't really care. We'll figure that out. But that's the 11, 12, and 13 out of the way. And with that, let's dive into number 10. These are in no specific order whatsoever. None... Well, there's one specific order. But there's no... For the most part, there's no specific order. These aren't ranked in best and worst and all that.
Specific order.
Whatever. Oh, pick number 14. Pick number 14. Well, let's do pick number 14. Don't look. You can't look.
You have it over there? We're only doing 10.
Wait, what? We're doing 10. I know, pick number 14 is I'm going to pair it up with another. So I'm not going to do it in order.
Okay.
Let's start with pick number 10, and we'll do pick number 14 a little later. All right. Pick number 10 is Cthulhu Death May Die.
That makes sense.
Yeah, it does make sense.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
I love this game. I adore this game. This is an amazing game. It's an amazing experience. You've played it like a few times. Yeah. Not enough yet.
Yeah,
we should play this sometime.
I've played it 4 times now.
Ooh, nice.
I've done 1 and 2 twice.
I've played episode 1 more than you've played this game the entire time. I've played episode 1 like 7, 8 times. I love it. It's my constant introduction to people.
Yeah, we really loved it, but we didn't get to play enough, and then when we went back to it, we decided to start in the beginning.
Yeah, that could happen. Yeah. Cthulhu May Die is an episodic game, not campaign-based, episodic. You could, I mean, what we play it right now is if your characters die, then we just, I mean, if you lose a mission, all those characters are dead, you have to pick new characters and keep going.
Mm-hmm.
That doesn't work if you just have the base game, because the base game gives you like 10 characters, but we have the Kickstarter stuff, which gives you 40 characters, so the degree of permanence. That's just our own made-up rule. You don't have to do that. It's episodic in nature. You're going to be combining an Elder God with an episode, and you're going to be combining those into a scenario you go through, which is effectively a dungeon crawler where you're going to be leveling up and using your... you're going to be leaning into your madness to basically level up your characters and have more abilities as you progressively go more insane until eventually you actually go insane and just die, and that's a bad thing. But until then, it's great, and it feels a lot of fun, and that's why I love this game. The dungeon crawler combined with the leveling up is just...
Yeah.
So good.
I feel like, and I'm sure you have more experience with this, but the leveling up, I'm still at the point in playing it that I'm trying to figure out what the best options are.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I'm still kind of figuring out the balance of what things I want to level up, and, like, do you usually go, like, level up an ability all the way, or do you try to balance?
I try. It depends. It is scenario dependent, and it is, like, situation and combination dependent, but I find the fourth level of every ability is so strong that I just want to get there.
I usually do that too. I usually pay into one.
Yeah.
And then sometimes I'm like, is that the right choice? I don't know.
It's hard. It's always a hard balance. And like, I would say I usually do one of two things. I either pick one track to go heavily up and then have like one and one of the others, or I pick two tracks to try to go as high up as possible.
Yeah.
And that's usually where the decision is more split. But I always want one track at the very least at the very end.
Yeah, I agree.
It's like if you have just marksman and you're just shooting into the next space and you're rolling 14 extra dice and you're applying and you can shoot two spaces away. It's just like, it gets to a point where you're like, I'm just going to kill everything and I roll well in games. So that's you, not me. Feels boss. It feels boss. The whole thing feels boss.
And it has amazing miniatures.
Yes.
Absolutely fantastic miniatures that are so fun.
Yeah. You don't have the Kickstarter version of this game.
No, right? I don't.
Ooh, you should try to get one.
I should.
You now have contacts, so come on, don't
I
you?
Should. You should.
Try to get a Kickstarter version.
Come on.
Come on. I'm going to send this video and maybe we'll see what we can do.
This will still be in frame if you don't push it up.
Want them in frame. I like stacking them in frame.
Sorry,
I like stacking them.
Do you want to stack it near me?
We can start off by near you.
Yeah.
That was a little aggressive.
That was. My poor baby.
I'd give you my box, except my box is worse, and which tells you how to treat games.
I just sit in them.
Number 9. Actually, let's do it this way, Meg. Do you want to pick a game that you think made its way into my picks?
Yeah, for sure. After the Kemet thing, and I'm a little nervous about my miniatures up there, because I know... Inish, I usually keep up above the game shelf because it lights up with the lights. Is Inish part of it? Show me Inish!
Show me Inish! It's gonna stack. Games are gonna fall.
Is it at the bottom?
One second. No, it's not at the bottom, but it's getting close to the bottom.
I think I know at least a few that you have.
Okay.
You're tricking me up that there's one missing from over there, but I think it's just back here.
Inish! I grabbed the expansion.
Inish. That makes me feel a little better.
In general, I just grab things that were easier to grab, so you may see expansion boxes here that are, otherwise, the base game, but...
Great cover, though.
It is a great cover.
I do really love this one.
I love your art. Your art version, we've talked about this. Mm-hmm. You have the better art version. And you think I have the better art version. No, I didn't. Because it's underneath things, and things were in the way. And
I have a lot of D&D miniatures in front of it.
Yeah, that's a thing. Anyways, Inish, you want to tell everyone why this game is so good?
Oh my gosh. It is a game where it is area control, but you are doing all of it based on card actions that you are drafting. And drafting is something that I love in games so much.
It's ridiculously good.
So much.
It's ridiculously good. It's not the last game here that has drafting, for the record.
Ooh.
Yeah.
Yeah, I love drafting. And especially with Inish, we've talked about this a lot, but I played a lot at two-player. Alex plays it at a higher player count. And as someone who is obsessed with drafting, I like memorizing what cards I'm passing and where it's going and what your hand is compared to what my hand is. I love that.
Yeah, there should be a gameplay on my channel at some point, mm-hmm. I think. I don't mm-hmm. know when it's going up. We have lots of things behind. I don't know, this video goes up.
We do a review of it, too.
We do. That's like a little chit-chat. Isn't that yours?
Yeah.
Yeah,
so yeah, they'll both be out, maybe.
Maybe. We'll have links at some point in some way.
They're coming if they're not here.
Exactly. Inish is a great game. I happen to think the expansion is mostly unnecessary. Mm-hmm. I like the fact that the expansion gives you extra epic tail cards.
But as a fifth player, right?
As a fifth player. Yeah. That's not relevant for you.
Right, sure. Yeah.
I have played with the fifth player twice, and I did enjoy the fifth player. So that's why the mostly is, like, I mm-hmm. usually don't use a fifth player. The other modules I don't use, and I use the epic tail cards. So, like, mm-hmm. it's like a mixed bag of things. I like the expansion. I'm not saying don't get the expansion. I'm saying the game is amazing, and the expansion is, you can get it or not, depending on your personal requirements. Let's continue the game of you picking one you think is there.
One I know that must be there is Terraforming Mars.
Terraforming Mars!
Show me Terraforming Mars!
The second game, I have to like rearrange things at this point over here to get things. I didn't plan this whole asking Meg to pick things over here. Terraforming Mars is the next pick over here.
Wait. We gotta preface this because I know which Terraforming Mars you grabbed.
I grabbed the Rickbox one.
Yeah.
The one that's not your actual copy.
Yeah, so this is a second copy, guys, and I just have to disclaimer because I take care of my stuff. This is it's a copy that I got to do arts and crafts with the pieces, so that's why it's a little hurt right now. Maybe I should do something funny with sitting in this because it's broken. Maybe April Fool's, I'll sit in this as broken.
Oh no, I broke my box.
Oops.
Yeah.
So yeah, just disclaimer that I treat my things very nicely. But yeah, Terraforming Mars. Terraforming Mars is one of the first games I really loved and got into as soon as I got into content creation, which is nice and, like, nostalgic for me that, like, I always took pictures of, like, gameplay and stuff, like, for myself and when I would be doing things of, like, epic moments. But this was one of the first games I really started, like, taking photos of and doing a video about, and I fell in love with it literally the moment I played it. I played it once, and it was, like, 1 a.m. when we finished, and I said, please, can we play again?
It's a good game. Is that when you filmed your video?
I filmed it the very next morning.
Oh my gosh.
The next morning.
This is one of the first videos I watched on your channel, which is, I mean, why not? Because it's Terraforming Mars.
Yeah.
But it's such a good game. It has drafting. Do you play with drafting? I don't know if I ever asked you that.
No.
You don't play Terraforming Mars with drafting.
Okay, guys, I don't know. I'm not going to get into this right now.
Okay, we'll talk about it.
There are reasons. There are reasons about my different gameplays on Terraforming Mars. I've loved every single one. The people I play with don't always love it. So,
okay.
Do
you play with Prelude?
No, I just got Prelude.
Okay, you should play with Prelude and with Death Drafting.
Okay,
The pain on my face.
I don't love it as much as you do. I know it's one of your top games. I do love it, but again, like, I don't get to play it enough.
We should work on that.
Yeah, I would love to.
Yeah,
I would love to.
Anyways, this is Terraforming Mars.
Amazing. You don't talk about it at all.
you want to talk about it. I'm tearing up at the fact that she plays it not the wrong way. Shouldn't say the wrong way.
Whoa, your fun is wrong.
No. The way I like to play and think is ideal, I'm tearing up that you're not getting that experience. That is how strongly I feel about this game.
Yeah.
It is so good. It's just so good. It's just so good. It's got drafting, it's got tableau building, it's got a ton of every experience is variable in terms of the feeling you get, mm-hmm. the corporations, the prelude cards, all the things you get drive different strategies you're going for. The ways you can win this game are vastly varied. There are so different strategies. The strategy I chose the last game, oh my gosh, it's just so good. It's just so, so good.
One of the things I love about it is that you are placing cities and you're also placing forests. Mm-hmm. And they score different points for you. And I love watching people start dropping their forests like no tomorrow.
And then,
oh, it's so fun to strategically place around what other people are placing. They don't see what they're doing. Like, it's really fun. Yeah. That I love about it.
It's a good game. It's a very good game. Lots of pathways of three. Any other guesses? Because you're probably going to do better on this one than a lot of people would in this whole guessing game because you have a lot of good games that you know I like.
Yeah, I'm really good at knowing my collection. Like, even looking around, should I cheat from one that I think is missing?
Absolutely.
That I just noticed not on the show?
Absolutely.
I'm gonna go with a new favorite in my life, Mythic Mischief.
Dun dun dun! Mythic Mischief! Fun fact about this one, I was about to grab The Loop as one of my games. I was gonna have a whole conversation about why.
I would play this over that.
So that's why it's here.
Yeah.
What happened is I was literally going
to... Oh, hold it. I love this one.
I was going to go ahead and I was going to grab Spirit Island and The Loop and have them tied for my number 10 pick and explain what I already explained.
Mm-hmm.
The fact
mm-hmm.
that I think Spirit Island is a better game for me, but, like, The Loop's currently higher for me at the mm-hmm. moment. Just mm-hmm. at the moment. Don't just breathe. It's all
this
good.
Is
it's
great.
All good.
It's so much fun.
And then on the way to grab The Loop, Mythic Mischief was right there. I was like, I didn't see this one here. I forgot you have this.
This wasn't on our list of things to play.
We already played it. We'll play it again. We have lots of things.
Every time I do these kind of videos, I'm like, I want to go play all of these right now.
But Mythic Mischief, I saw it on the way, and I was like, I have to grab this one. Are you getting the final game from them?
I hope so.
Yeah, this is
I
the
sure
prototype.
I sure hope so.
This is my prototype.
Yeah, this
prototype.
Is... I'm holding on to this prototype forever because I don't get rid of games.
Yeah, we can work on that. I'll reclaim ownership of this as soon as you get the real version. Just to help you get rid of a game.
No. Okay. No, I have memories with it now.
I have the new version of Mythic Mischief, the official giant big box version of it, so I don't need this anymore. But Mythic Mischief is a fantastic abstract game from Ivy Games that is just absolutely delightful in the level of thinking and double thinking and trying to find the optimization through the puzzle as you go through the experience of trying to basically outpace the other person. You haven't played the team blitz mode yet, but that's a fully delightful, different experience of the game that is a lot of fun. I will almost always end up playing the two-player version, just practically speaking, but that four-player blitz mode with the timer and everything, where you have two maps set up and you're going at it, it's just so good. The entire experience is just very, very good and very thinky and very variable because of the different factions and all the asymmetric abilities of it. I adore the game. I absolutely adore the game.
The thing I love about this one is that when we played, we scored very, very closely.
Yes.
That's one of my favorite things when you score very closely in games, that there's no clear winner throughout the entire thing, and then, you know, someone just comes through in the end. That when you can be clearly ahead of someone, that's not as fun for me.
Yeah.
Something like this, it felt like it was just balanced so well.
Yeah. It's a solid game. Solid game.
Yeah. Definitely a favorite.
Any other guesses as we work our way down the list? 10 games. You won't get them all, just, I mean, practically speaking, it's harder and harder with each guess.
Is Dune?
Dune Imperium?
I wasn't sure.
It's a surprise pick on this list.
Oh, I hate the way you're throwing it around. So this is something I complain about a lot. The storage, the insert for Dune is horrible.
Do you not bag things?
No.
Oh, I bag everything. I'm so sorry. I'm treating your games like my games.
It's fine. I can show you what that one's like on the inside. It's not great. It's not bad.
It's
all sleeved, so.
It's a terrible insert. I bag all my components
horrible
so that
insert.
You have cards in here and they're not bagged?
Do you want to see?
No, I don't anymore.
It's not bad. I'm sure it's not bad. You can talk about Dune Imperium.
Dune Imperium is a game that I was going through the shelves and trying to figure out what I'd pick. Now, for
context... Yeah, see, it's not bad.
Oh, that's not bad.
It's all sleeved.
Okay.
So it's all... It's not as bad as I thought it would be.
I was going through the shelves over here and trying to figure out what I wanted to pick and what would go on this list. Go ahead, what you want to say?
This was... So, guys, I did a video on the Boardbenders where Roberto grabbed a bunch... I think it was maybe 10 games, maybe 5. But I was blindfolded and I had to guess what the game was. And from this insert and from these being sleeved, I knew exactly... I felt these things. This is what they give you to help with the insert. These bits of foam. So, from that alone, I knew what this game was.
Some games like to hold strong to the tradition of having garbage inserts with great games, and Dune Imperium is one of those games.
Yeah,
but anyways, this game is absolutely delightful. And for context, this is one of those things where I'm picking the 10 best games in your collection, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so, to some extent, there's a degree of, okay, Alex, well, why do you pick this game over that game when these are your top... Like, what about, like, you know, Spirit Island was my number, like, 12 game of all time, something like that last year. And I'm picking Dune Imperium, which is my number 88, okay? So why am I picking Dune Imperium over Spirit Island? Two reasons. One is Spirit Island, with each repeated play, until I've added expansions, I have not done so yet, it does feel like it's getting a little bit less exciting for me each time I play it. And two is, I've played Dune Imperium with the expansion multiple times since rating it. And the expansion really takes it up a notch for me. Dune Imperium was a game I always enjoyed. It's a deck-building worker placement game.
Mm-hmm.
But I always said that when I played it. I said, this is a great game. It's my number 88 of all time. That's not a small thing. But at the same time, it's my number 88 of all time, with the context that when I play it, it does feel like it's in a very repetitive cycle of the water, spice, money, the water, spice, money, go ahead and get these different bonuses.
The spice must flow.
The spice must flow. It felt repetitive in the general cycle while still feeling like a great experience. Again, both things are true. I'm complaining about one aspect of the game while ranking it as my number 88 of all time.
Mm-hmm.
But then you add the Rise of Ix expansion and it opens up the gameplay to be a lot more flexible, to have a lot more options, to have more strategies you can try to pursue. Do you want those dreadnoughts in battle, or do you want to get that third put worker? Like, how do you want to divide and focus your attention? The last game of Dune I played, oh my gosh, it was the best game ever. Were you part of the game? You were part of the game.
Yeah.
Another gameplay on my channel. The last game...
I think I mentioned that somewhere as well.
Oh, it's so good. So, again, hopefully that video is up beforehand, because I don't know, but Dune Imperium, I have a Dune Imperium gameplay on my channel. This is a slight spoiler, so skip to the next game if you don't want it, or just skip to the next game. It's a spoiler if you watch the gameplay. But I played that, I won't even say who won, but I played that game without once advancing on any of the faction tracks, and I was competitive the entire time.
Mm-hmm.
That's insane. It's so good. It's so good.
Yeah.
I love this game. It's going up on my list.
So I want to say, I really fell in love with Dune Imperium because I started as a TCG player and then I loved Ascension, which is deck building. This was one of the first times I saw deck building really change with the worker placement. That, like, I've seen other games like that, but this one did it so well for me that as a card player, it really hits the spot for me.
Solid game.
Yeah, it's really great. Really, really great.
Another choice? I can give you a hint.
No, don't give me a hint. I think I can get a little further. Let's see. Games that you enjoy that I enjoy.
That I love. That I love. That you enjoy.
It's funny. This is a little... I'm going to go on a tangent for a second.
By all means, tangent away. This is Boarding Co. All we do is rambles.
Alex is visiting, and we have a extensive list of games to play that we wanted to get to. I almost asked you to play Dune today when we had a little bit of free time. I was almost like, should we just play Dune?
It's just a good game. Just a good game.
Gloomhaven isn't in your list, is it?
I didn't say that.
Gloomhaven?
Gloomhaven, which was going to be my number one pick.
What?
So, this is a bit of a cheat.
I made you love Gloomhaven!
Yeah, absolutely you did. Gloomhaven's a bit of a cheat here, partially because Meg's like, if you're taking this box off the shelf, I was like, I'm not taking that box off the shelf. She's like, you're not? Because she was giving me a whole guideline of how to fill the gaps to make sure...
I
can
see it behind me in the viewfinder, I was like...
Mm. Yeah, and she was like, because you were wondering if I was lying to you up until that point?
I just wasn't sure.
So Meg asked,
I was judging you for not picking Gloomhaven.
Yeah, of course it's here. You can make a tier of how to pick things off the shelf and how to proxy and stuff in the background to make sure the gaps are filled, all that stuff. And she's like, for example, Gloomhaven, blah, blah, blah. And I was like, no, I'm not taking that box off the shelf. She's like, you're not?
I was like, are you sure though?
And I was like, that's because I'm going to grab Jaws of the Lion, which is much easier. I don't want to deal with picking that thing up. Gloomhaven, though. Jaws of the Lion is a proxy and a stand-in, but honestly, both are great. I prefer Gloomhaven. Gloomhaven is, and I would recommend Jaws of the Lion first, but I prefer Gloomhaven.
As it should be. This is more of an intro. There's a bit cut out of it. Gloomhaven has more. Frosthaven will have even more.
Yeah, Frosthaven I'm excited for now, too. I was not excited for it before. But I've been playing through Gloomhaven.
You didn't back Frosthaven.
I don't need to. I'm going to be playing Frosthaven digitally.
Sure.
Probably. I imagine. I don't imagine I'm playing it physically.
Sure.
Yeah. But either way, Gloomhaven is a game that I always enjoyed when I first played it. Mm-hmm. Always enjoyed it. That was never the question. I played Gloomhaven. I liked it a lot. I kept my collection for 3 years unplayed because I had played three scenarios. And I was like, this is a fun game. I really like the system. But I didn't play it because it's a hard game to table. Come along you, which is half the reason we do all these things together. We did a longer story as to how we started working together and doing all these things. But a part of that conversation was, hey, let's play Gloomhaven on Twitch.
Yeah.
And we've been playing Gloomhaven over on Twitch, Camp Co-op, link down below, link in all the videos to that. But we're playing through Gloomhaven and other games, but primarily Gloomhaven, twice a week, Tuesdays and Thursday nights, generally. We dive into Gloomhaven Digital, and we just go through the process of leveling up our characters, of exploring the world, of tackling the next adventure. And it's just so good.
Mm-hmm. And the card management and the hand management with the abilities. How many times, I can't tell you how many times Alex with his Vermling said, I got him. I got this. I got the whole room. I can do this. You were great.
Oh, it was amazing. Honestly, the fact that this is still here, even though my Vermling has retired and is gone, and my resentment for Gloomhaven has risen, and my appreciation has not yet gone up.
Alex went through his first retirement.
Yeah, it's tough. It's tough. Right now I'm trying to learn whether I love Hatchet or the Spellweaver, or just give up entirely on and pick someone else. Not give up entirely.
So you could replay a new Vermling.
Not gonna happen.
I know. I just wanted to give you that option.
I'm enjoying the Spellweaver. I think Hatchet was a little easier. So my Vermling retired. Dove into Hatchet and enjoyed Hatchet, but also not as much my gameplay style.
So glad we bought the Jaws of the Lion content. Oh, we're gonna play the Hatchet.
We're gonna play through Jaws of the Lion too.
Yeah, sure. Yeah, obviously.
Three other characters that I dive into, and you want Hatchet.
I kind of want to play the Void Warden.
Ooh.
I never got to play as the Void Warden. Mm. I would love to do that.
So maybe I'll take the Red Guard or the Glass. Yeah. We can figure
things
out.
Red Guard is also very interesting to me.
But right now I'm diving into the Spellweaver, trying her out again. She has an interesting cycle of pulling cards back. I'm getting way too bogged down in the weeds here. This is a dungeon crawler with card play that is epically amazing. It is an investment, both financially.
It's a campaign game with branching storylines that you're playing through.
The Jaws of the Lion is going to give you most of that experience at a easier entry point, both both financially, setup-wise, and just everything. It will come at the cost of some concepts, like your various managing your summons, or things like retirement. Mm-hmm. There are some consequences you don't have in Jaws of the Lion.
There's no prosperity or anything like that.
No prosperity, yeah. It's easier to manage. Yeah. I would definitely recommend Jaws of the Lion. I think if you don't like Jaws of the Lion, I don't think you'll like Gloomhaven, and vice versa. I think they have enough overlap that you're kind of going to have enough. If you enjoy one, you might enjoy the other more. That's possible. But I don't think you're going to enjoy one without the other. But yeah.
To the kids that know Gloomhaven, and you'll now understand this, in Jaws of the Lion, there's an event card that's a little cheeky.
Yeah.
And it says something where a guy wants you to pay him money so that he can start tracking your progress. Mm. And the flavor text at the bottom when you say no is, if prosperity was important, you'd track it yourself. Isn't that so good? Because you actually do later.
That's cute.
Yeah.
Anyways, that's Gloomhaven.
The only quick thing to say as well, for price points and things like that, and for getting into Gloomhaven, if you want something that's more accessible, we're now at the point where we can recommend Gloomhaven Digital, which is a lot more affordable, a lot easier. You don't set it up at all, so it is
It has trade-offs and downsides, but overall, yeah. I mean, honestly, one of the things, I don't know if I told you this yet, but I want to do a full video on Gloomhaven Digital and why you should get it.
I think that'd be great.
Yeah. Anyways.
And I'll be the other side. Rather play physical.
Really?
Absolutely, every time. I'm the Hermione of our group.
How do you not have this conversation?
I run the monsters and everything. I would rather set up 3 scenarios in one night and be the one to set it up completely by myself than play digital.
Well, we'll have that problem with Crimson Scales, though.
Yeah.
Because Crimson Scales does not have digital, and we'll have to
play physically. There's no problem. We'll just play.
Yeah, we'll just play physically.
A fun thing about Gloomhaven, I know we talk about the different rules that I don't know. Mm-hmm. One rule I have never, ever learned is the monster placement on the maps. Because I always set up the maps for us, and the one thing I want hidden knowledge for me is how many enemies will spawn and if they're elite or not. So that's the one rule I purposely have never learned in setup.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Very cool.
Yeah.
Yep. And with that, we go to the next pick, which is...
I don't know. You might have to...
We have 4 more down here. 4 great games.
One of which I don't want to look around, because that's cheating.
I think you should be able to get 2 of these.
Should I look around?
No, that's cheating.
No?
One of them you're going to beat yourself up about.
Okay, just tell me some, because I was going to guess Moonrakers, just because...
I'll start... No, I like Moonrakers. It's not top 10 for me. Yeah, not even close. Yeah, and I'll be transparent. I like Moonrakers a lot. I like it even more with the expansion.
That would have been hard to take out, too.
It would have been hard to take out. I figured out. Whatever. But yeah, Moonrakers is not making the list over here. I'll start with one that I do not think you'd get, because I just don't think you'd get it.
Okay.
Which is... I mean, you'll know I like it, but... Everdell. Yeah.
I haven't played that one enough.
It's so part of the requirement, not requirement, part of my mental aspect of picking these games was literally the sheer joy of looking at it and thinking, I want to play that. You know, we talked about, like, I want to play it now, like, change our plans, forget that. Almost all of these games fall into the category of, I want to play that now. Jaws of the Lion, not, because we're in the middle of a digital campaign elsewhere, but the others of these, I'll drop everything and play any of these games right now.
All I maybe totally have fun. A guess for the next one now.
Oh, well then, yeah. We have Everdell. Everdell is one, which is one that every single time I play it,
and you haven't played with the expansions, because you asked about that.
No, I have not played with the expansions. Okay. I didn't want to. Absolutely. I played with one of the newer expansions they had in the last Kickstarter campaign. I played with one of those, but I have not played with any of the other expansions of the actual available expansions. Mm-hmm. I played with one of the future expansions, and that's it.
Yeah.
But I love Everdell. I every single time I play it, I'm like, I want to play it again, and I want to play with the expansions, and I want to dive into this more, but it's just ridiculously enjoyable. It's worker placement. It's also got worker placement and card management.
Absolutely beautiful. Yeah. Great components. You got these, like, squishy berries.
Oh, yeah. Squishy berries. Lots of games are trying to replicate those squishy berries. They get a lot of press.
I really enjoy Everdell. How many do you usually play it at?
I would say most of the time I've played Everdell at 3. I don't think I've ever actually played it at 4. I don't recall. I might have. 2 and 3, but 3 being the more common.
I usually play it at 2, and the one complaint, the only thing that I don't love about Everdell is that...
Yeah, we have been watching.
I think that we stopped off with what I said about the board being stagnant. Mm-hmm.
Say the one thing you don't like about Everdell. So we'll jump in. Brief cut for a full... No, sorry.
Good.
Brief cut there for a full card, but you were saying?
Yeah, we had to reset the camera. But the one thing that I don't love about Everdell is that the main market board can get a little stagnant. Mm-hmm. I wish that it refreshed more often, because it does refresh between seasons.
I think it refreshes between seasons, and there's there's cards you can do to grab things out and cycle things, but it is definitely a complaint that I've had at
times. I would even pay resources to refresh it if you had to, if that was, an action you can do or something like that, but that's the one thing is that with all the cards that you're trying to get, if you're holding on to the husband and you're looking for your wife... How are you going
to
get her?
Yeah, it can be tough. I'm pretty sure, I have to check my review of it, but I'm pretty sure I did mention the market board. It's one thing I don't love.
Yeah.
But again, it's not the biggest thing in the worst, most worst. It's the kind of thing that's easy enough to house rule in a very simple rule.
Right.
Kind of thing. Like you said, pay resources. You can house rule it in to not be a problem. More of a problem at lower player counts, but even at 3, I've seen that be a little stagnant.
Yeah. Yeah, that's my one complaint.
Fantastic game.
But I really love Everdell.
Yep.
It's been too long.
Yep. And with that, let's go ahead and move to the next one, which is...
Oh my gosh, what was the one I thought of?
You thought of one. And you were right, probably, maybe.
Who knows? My gosh, what was it?
I can grab another one that I don't think you're going to think of.
No, wait, give me a second.
There's 2 you should have. I can give you hints. I can give you a hint for one of them easily. This is just way too much dead air.
Okay, sure. You just go to one.
The hint or the...
No. Just do one that you don't think.
The one that I don't think...
What was the one that I thought of?
The one that I don't think you're going to pick is Marvel Champions.
Okay.
Marvel Champions, which I absolutely adore. I have, like, way too much content for this, and I keep buying expansions even though I'm not playing it enough to justify those. But that's usually what I do when I love a game this much. But similar to Everdell, there's Marvel Champions is a game that every time I play it, I'm like, I should play this more. I primarily play it solo. I do play it two players. What are you smiling at?
I really don't want you holding it like that. This one, the way the cards are.
Yeah.
I just know how it is on the inside. We can tip it, but I don't want it, like, it's, I don't know, it's fine.
it's all good. It's all good. I mean, well, not all good. Apparently not all good. Marvel Champions is one that is a... It's a cooperative or solo deck building experience in which you are basically building out your deck. I end up using pre-made decks. I usually build them out. I have a whole system I use that was actually taught to me by Dale the Casual... It's not true. It was taught to Jesse by Quacklope, by Dale the Casual Gamer, and then I took it from Quacklope. So thanks, Dale and Jesse.
Did you say what it is?
The system they have is they just kind of... They don't actually keep their decks. And it made it, once I started doing this, it made it easier to table and I play it more often because of it. They don't actually... He doesn't keep his decks in a pre-constructed fashion, which is what I used to do. And then I'd walk in and be like, I don't remember where I left off with that deck. I don't remember. Do I just want to start again? And I'd make it harder to table. Mm-hmm. He just has all the card types sorted by their types. And then he'll grab a character and then just go through the process of being like, okay, great, I'm just building a deck. So he has certain preset decks where he kind of just jumps into it every single time, but set up in a way that it's accessible and easy to construct a deck where you're not overly investing a ton of time thinking about the best deck, but you're also not keeping a deck from game to game as you try to think through things. Mm-hmm. So it makes it, it potentially is the right decision for some and not the right decision for others. For someone like myself that jumps into Marvel Champions consistently but infrequently, so multiple times a year, but not like five times a week, that's the best way to handle it. And it worked really well for me, but I just have so much content for it. I love diving into it. I love building characters. I love the new characters. I love diving against the new whatever bosses or villains or situations they have and the schemes and all that stuff. It's just thoroughly enjoyable.
Did you say this? Did you say what that term is?
LCG.
It's an LCG, which is a living card game, which means that content is continuously coming out for it, and that's why you're able to add to your decks and stuff like that. Continuously buy stuff that I shouldn't, yes. Yeah, so future, hero decks will have other cards that you can apply back to these decks.
Yeah, so every time a new deck comes out, sure, I get, the new whatever, I don't know what a new one, like, they had, what did they have recently? They had Drax recently.
Spider-Ham.
But yeah, you can add some cards from their systems into their, you get a new card for, like, the red deck or the yellow deck, whatever, and you can add them into prior systems. You're basically choosing a facet along with a character, and then you can use the neutral cards as well, building out a deck, tackling a bunch of stuff.
Yeah, it's very smoothly done. For a cooperative card game, I feel like it moves really well. It's challenging, which is important for me for a cooperative game. I really enjoy it. I would have picked Spirit Island over this.
Oh, so it's funny you say that, because there was... I can't even tell you the third game, because the third game is one of the games I picked. There are three games I picked once that I was comparing why I like them and how much content they have and how variable they can be.
I thought of the game.
and Marvel Champions and Spirit Island were two of those games in the same conversation. Marvel Champions has still held up for me consistently. Spirit Island, again, base game only, and I know I should dive with expansions. Mm-hmm. It is finally starting to get a little repetitive with the base game. Again, that's a me problem. I have tons of expansion content I haven't touched. What's the game?
Is it Too Many Bones?
Too Many Bones was a third game in that category.
I thought of it before and then came back to it.
Too Many Bones, Marvel... I don't know how to hold these anymore. Too Many Bones, Marvel Champions, and Spirit Island were the three games that I talked about and compared in that sense.
This one you can hold up.
Yeah.
The way they've...
Too Many Bones. And this is also where the 14 comes in. Number 14, game number 14 that was not picked is...
Cloudspire.
Cloudspire is up there with Too Many Bones for me, and it's just I haven't played it enough yet. I played it a few times, and I want to play it more before I include it in a category like this.
Let's play it tonight,
exactly. That one's actually on our list of play, so
I know,
maybe.
I know.
Too Many Bones, though, every single time I dive into this experience, I enjoy it so much. Every single time I play Too Many Bones, the character depth, the variety, and how much stuff there is out there in the universe. Every single character. Again, people always ask me, who's your favorite Too Many Bones character? As if, like, I've played them all. I've played, like, four or five different characters. I haven't needed to dive into the number of characters I have, because I'd rather dive into the nuances of Stanza or Duster or what's it called? Oh my gosh, what's the Ang Tantrum? Or whatever characters I've played last. I'd rather dive into their nuances and figure out how to optimize around different strategies with them than continuously explore new characters, because it's like learning a new rule book. The way they have these characters is so in-depth, so much variety to the adventures you go on. This is a TTRPG in theory. It's a tabletop role-playing game. You have that building up your character, you have that adventure, that board game aspect of having scenario after scenario given to you and trying to figure out how to tackle them. I have complaints about them, I have reasons why there's this nitpick or that nitpick, but I overall love the Too Many Bones systems. It is absolutely one of my favorite games. It's my number 7 of all time last year.
Also, shout out to the quality of the components. I don't know if I should always focus on that, and that shouldn't be a focus, because it's it's fine to have, like, an okay game and then great components. This is a fantastic game that is beautifully done. So, like, as your characters, it's very fun to have these customized dice on a neoprene mat with the holes punched out. That, like, that's where you place them to keep track of things and then upgrade them, that it feels good. Yeah, I think that's part of the allure. It has an experience. I mean, yeah, it really does.
Yeah, I think... Bad, like, I can think of a game, this is a positive, it's not going to trash talk, but I can think of games where I like the game and the components tarnish that experience. I mean, many people would pick Terraforming Mars for that. I happen to not care as much, but in this particular experience, but bad components, bad art, bad anything can tarnish the experience, versus good components, good art, good whatever, can enhance an experience. Mm-hmm. This is both together all at once.
Yes, yes. Yeah. And it is, again, one of the things I like to bring up in games. This one's cheeky. It's very funny. There are things that are silly that happen. It's still very, like, fantasy-based, but some of it is just, like, the way it talks to you, it brings you into the story and talks directly at the reader. That I really enjoy that in an RPG-style game as well.
So, number one. And by the way, I'm going to give you credit for The Clue That May Die, because I think you would have picked that.
I think I definitely would have guessed that.
But my number one. So far, you're only missing two. You missed Marvel Champions. You missed Everdell. Can you go 8 for 10 on this? I could give you a hint.
Okay, wait. Instead of giving me a hint, can I rattle off and be wrong and keep going?
No.
Okay, then give me the hint.
Okay. The hint is it's related. It's adjacently related to one of the games already on the table. Mm. So just think in terms of this. Go through each of these games and say, if he picked this, he also would have picked that. Just say it aloud for each one.
That makes me think maybe Cthulhu, that you picked another Cthulhu-style game. Other than that, like, could you have picked Arnak with Dune?
My number 10 is Arnak. I told you, that's a good hit.
I didn't think that would be in it.
I love Arnak. I like Arnak.
Wow.
Oh, I love Arnak. Wow. I adore Arnak.
Now, I do too, but that's a surprise. I mean, again, it's a good hit. Spirit Island.
Oh, yes, absolutely over Spirit Island. I adore Arnak.
I love Co-op.
Arnak is so good. And Arnak has a solo version, in theory. I don't know if it's a co-op version, it has a solo version. But Arnak, and this is the expansion box, Expedition Leaders.
That's how we co-op with solo games.
Arnak is, Lost Ruins of Arnak is a delightful experience that last year, I can't remember the exact number, but it's my top 20, I believe.
Wow.
It was in my top, meaning it's
I would
like,
have it up there as well.
Yeah, it's very, very, very good. And for me, this is my top 20, and Dune Imperium was 88. Mm-hmm. The gap has very much closed to the point that when you watch my top 100 next year, I don't currently know which one's going to be higher. I've been saying Arnak for a bit, but I've also haven't played Arnak in several months, and each time I play Dune Imperium, it keeps going up for me. And so, like, it's like Arnak's kind of sitting there stagnant as Dune Imperium keeps rising. I guess I just need to play Arnak and find out.
Yeah.
But I adore Arnak. It's like another, the reason I said Dune Imperium is they're often compared, and with every time they're compared, you get one or two people who are like, why would you ever compare those games? Enough people That's do
sweet.
So.
I think
do
you really? I think they're different enough that...
Interesting.
Like...
They're different, but like... They're not, like, they're both deck-building worker placement games that came out roughly the same time. That's the big thing around them.
I think that is the thing, is that they came around the same time.
And so, overall, for me, I enjoyed both experiences. Deck-builder worker placement, very different theme. Dune Imperium's got more combat in it.
I think that's a good point, though, is that we talk about the differences, and I think you disagree, which I'm really excited to play Arnak with you. Mm-hmm. But for me, I feel like Dune is a deck-building game with worker placement. I feel like Arnak is worker placement with deck building.
Yeah.
And you do a lot more deck building than Arnak.
And I think we talked about this last time. We mentioned this at one point. But yeah, when I play Arnak, I usually heavily get a lot of cards and I heavily cycle my deck.
Yeah.
And I feel like there's a lot more control over my deck building in Arnak than there is in Dune Imperium.
Yeah.
But overall, I love this game. I enjoy the game so much. It's got great art, great production quality. This is one of those games, you pull up the components, you're like, is this the Kickstarter Deluxe version? And I was like, there's no Kickstarter. This is just the basic version of the game.
Yeah, the components are so fun. Yeah. The little tile ones.
Also a garbage insert, though, just
for
the record.
Yeah, another horrible insert.
Waste of time. Waste of space.
Yeah.
Everything's bagged in my box. No space for anything else. But yeah, it's got beautiful pieces, excellent gameplay, lots of variety to the experience, lots of cards. The raid has expansion. Like Dune Imperium, the expansion Expedition Leaders very much enhanced the base game. I love this game. I absolutely adore it. It was top 20 from my last year. Don't know what it'll be next. Don't know what it'll be in my collection list this year, but it's still going to be up there, I'll tell you that much. But yeah. And these are the 10 games.
This is a pretty good list, Alex. I was trying to look around and think, like, what I would substitute for other games. And truly, I think the only thing is that I would maybe bump this out for Spirit Island.
Mm-hmm.
Other than that, I'm not going to judge. I don't think I would change too many.
There's a lot of good games.
Maybe personally I would. But that's more... I think we've found, especially this week, that I love games for nostalgia, maybe not necessarily for gameplay.
Mm-hmm.
So I think this is a really good, solid top 10.
I like these a lot. And yeah. I don't do nostalgia. Not quite as much. Not a lot.
I don't do nostalgia.
I have light tracings of nostalgia. Like, I think nostalgia influences my choices when it comes to comparable games. Like, a good example that I bring up is Five Tribes. Five Tribes is one of the older games in my collection, and I don't play it that often. And I think I've probably played better games since then that I get rid of those and keep Five Tribes. Mm-hmm. But I do have that Five Tribes was a great game, and it held up, and it's a really solid system. Catan lasted longer than my collection because of nostalgia. Lasted longer. It's not there now. But yeah, lots of solid games out there.
I couldn't tell you the last time I played Catan.
I actually sort of got it back recently. Longer conversation here. I got it back just to review it for the sake of WSBG, mm-hmm. Rules mm-hmm. of Board Gaming, because I'm reviewing all their games. Mm-hmm. But past that, I decided to hold on to it temporarily because Ricky does like it. My daughter does mm-hmm. like it. Yeah. But that's it. These are your top 10 best games for SMX Collection. Solid list of games. Yeah. High recommendations. Yeah. They may or may not be featured in other people's videos if I do this in the future, when I do this in the future. But that's basically it. I'll link to all the videos we discussed down below.
Alex will always start with Terraforming Mars.
Terraforming Mars. I'm going to have them
always.
I guess I would have... I have to figure out how I'll do it. Because I'd have to have them guess, but give them points for things that would have made the list if I don't pick them.
Sure.
Yeah, that's tricky. Sure. In any case, until next time, I'm Alex Radcliffe from Board Game Co.
I'm Professor Meg.
And I hope you have a good one.
Bye.